So electronegativity trends in periodic table.
Yeah.
Do you know about the groups and periods in the periodic table?
Yeah.
Okay. So what are periods?
So periods are the number, so the number of energy levels an atom has, or an element has. So if there's period one, like hydrogen or helium, they only have one energy level in their structure.
Okay. Have you gone through the periodic table like this format? Have you ever seen it?
Yeah.
Okay. So in this periodic table, horizontal rows are called periods. Do you know this? Like these
yeah.
rows. How many periods are there in the periodic table? Seven periods?
Yeah.
Do you know this thing or not?
Yeah, yeah.
Seven periods and 18 vertical columns called groups.
Yeah.
Like these are the groups, group 1, group 2, then 3 to 12, then 13 to 18. Vertical columns, they are known as groups, and horizontal rows, they are periods. Is it fine?
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. Now, if you want to know what will be the trend of electronegativity in a period, like suppose we consider period number 2nd, there are 7 periods, no? Like first period, if I draw again here, first period has elements hydrogen, helium. Second period has lithium, beryllium, boron, carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, fluorine, neon. These 8 elements come in period 2. Then you have period 3rd from sodium to argon, like this.
Right? Yeah.
And do you know, like in a period, the atomic size decreases? Do you know this?
Yeah. Yeah.
Like suppose if I want to consider the elements from lithium to neon, the size will vary like this. If we want to imagine, it will be like this. Isn't it?
Yeah.
Okay. Can you tell me why size decreases in a period?
Because the proton number increases and the electrostatic forces are stronger and it pulls the element closer together and more tight.
Yeah, proton number increases, or another way we can say nuclear charge increases.
Nuclear charge, yeah.
Nuclear charge increases. But there is a question that as nuclear charge increases, electron numbers are also increasing. Then why it becomes dominating factor?
Why does it become?
Dominating factor. No? If nuclear charge increases only, then it will pull the electrons closer and the size will decrease. Isn't it?
Yeah.
Like suppose if we compare lithium and beryllium, the lithium atomic number is 3. Z value 3 means lithium has 3 protons and 3 electrons.
Yeah.
And beryllium has 4 protons and 4 electrons. Now you are saying that the proton number is increasing, or I am saying like nuclear charge increases. Both have the same meaning, fine?
Yeah.
But as the proton is increasing, like suppose if we draw that of lithium, like a picture comes in our mind like this, and plus 4. And this, and you are saying that it is plus 4, so it will pull the electrons closer, so size will decrease, isn't it?
Yeah.
But I am asking, like, if proton are increasing, electron number is also increasing, then why they are not cancelling each other?
Because it's the sea of electron and the proton and electron aren't in a fixed position. Huh?
No, the reason is that the electrons are being added in the same shell. Means if you, let me explain, if you want to write the configuration of lithium, it is 1s2, 2s1, isn't it? And that of beryllium is 1s2, 2s2. Now see, in lithium, the last electron is in second shell. N means shell number, second shell. It is 2s. Mm. And in beryllium, the last electron is also in second shell only. The shell number has not increased. Now, if the electrons are present in the same shell, it means the distance has not increased so much and the proton number is increased. So, it will be able to pull the electrons more closer towards it. So, this is the reason that electrons are being added in the same shell. If the shell number is increasing, suppose I am talking about the group. Let us take any group number one. Do you know group number one, alkali metals? Lithium, sodium, potassium, rubidium, cesium, francium. Now, size increases down the group. Fine. So, what is the reason for this? The reason is that shell number increases. Shell number increases means 1s2, 2s1, 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, 3s1. Now, as you go from lithium to sodium, the shell is increased from second shell to the third shell. So, size increase will be there. Distance between nucleus and electron has increased because valence electron has shifted to the next shell. Are you getting?
Mm. Yeah.
Now, if you see, the proton are also increasing from lithium to sodium, but the effect is not that that high. Effect of number of shells is more here. As shells are increasing, it is becoming farther and farther apart, so size is increasing. And why here the shell remains same, that is why the size is not increasing, rather it is decreasing because due to the increase in the nuclear charge, and more technically we call it as effective nuclear charge. Why we call it as effective nuclear charge? Because effect of the nucleus is dominative here. Why the effect of the nucleus is dominative? Because the electrons are remaining in the same shell. If you check all the elements, next element is boron. 1s2, 2s2, 2p1. Now you may ask that, ma'am, the shell, now it is 2p. But you see the shell is same, second shell. Subshell is s and p, but shell is only the second shell. That is why the size is decreasing in a period. Is it clear?
Yeah. Yeah, it is.
Okay. So electronegativity, now it is about the size. What happened to the electronegativity? Electronegativity increases in a period. Do you know this?
Electron, say that again. Increases.
Increases as we move along a period. What do you mean by moving along a period? Like we are moving from left to right. Like this. Yes. Why electronegativity will increase?
Because the nuclear charge increases.
Nuclear charge increases, so it will pull the electrons more towards it. And what is electronegativity? Tendency to attract
the shared electron pair.
Shared electron pair, yeah. So it will attract more the shared electron pair towards it. So we can say electronegativity is increasing. Fine.
Yeah.
So, like basically, there are three factors: size, nuclear charge, and there is one more factor, shielding effect. Now, just try to relate size with the electronegativity. Smaller size atom will have more electronegativity, or bigger size atom in general?
Smaller size.
So in a period, size is decreasing.
Yeah.
So electronegivity
is increasing. Increase.
Okay. Now try to correlate nuclear charge with electronegativity. General trend. What will be general idea? If someone has high nuclear charge, will it be more electronegative or less electronegative?
So the more the as the increase of nuclear charge when there's more nuclear charge, the electronegativity also increases.
Yeah. It's very good. So again, the same funda, the in a period size in decreasing, electronegativity increases, nuclear charge increasing, electronegativity increasing. Right?
Yeah.
Okay. Before discussing shielding effect, can you please tell me what will be the trends of electronegativity down the group? As we move down the group, what will happen?
It would decrease.
It will decrease because size is?
Getting larger.
Yeah.
Size is
becoming bigger and bigger. Is it clear? Except shielding effect?
Yeah, it is, yeah.
Okay. Do you know shielding effect?
Yeah, it's just, because you're going down the group, you're increasing the number of shells, which is, blocking the valence electron from the nucleus. So it's shielding the nucleus.
Very good, very good. Absolutely. Like suppose it's the nucleus and here is the electron. If no other electron is present in between the shells, the electron will be pulled towards the nucleus with full force.
Yeah.
Now, if in between more electrons are present, there will be electron-electron repulsions. Now, suppose a nucleus is putting 100 force to this valence electron, but due to repulsion of this and this, some force is also going this way as well.
Yeah.
So nucleus is not able to pull it with the 100 force. So force of the nucleus, or you can say pull of the nucleus towards the valence electron decreases due to the inner electrons. So basically they are shielding. They are behaving like a shield. So this effect is known as shielding effect. Right?
Yeah.
Now try to correlate shielding effect with electronegativity.
So as there's more shielding, the electronegativity decreases.
Yes, more shielding, electronegativity will be lesser. Very good, because the nuclear pull will decrease. I think the topic is clear to you now.
Yeah, it is. Yeah, I'll do the summary questions later as well.
Yeah, you have not sent me that. Practice problems.
Yeah. What I'll do is after I complete this, after we do this, I'll do all the questions straight away. It's just yesterday I had to go work straight away and I forgot about the questions.
No issues. Weekends are lazy, Anna.
Yeah.
Okay. Explain why fluorine is more electronegative than chlorine.
So, because there's less shielding in fluorine than chlorine, there is more nuclear pull in fluorine.
Smaller size.
It's also a smaller size.
Yeah.
Second. So one, there's more.
I think you will be able to do the first question very well, isn't it?
Yeah. So there's less shielding in fluorine and it's a smaller size and
higher nuclear charge.
Higher nuclear charge.
Effective nuclear charge will be more, you can say.
Yeah. Is there anything else I need to say?
No, that's it for the first question. Second?
Okay. Write delta
plus and delta minus signs to show the polarity of bonds in hydrogen chloride molecule. It's quite easy. Yesterday we discussed it.
Yeah. Let me just get hydrogen chloride. So is that HCl? Do I need to make the lone pairs as well?
Yeah, you can make it. No issues. Okay. If you want to show, just try to show it as a whole.
All right, 1 second. We just be like that.
Yes, yeah, but yeah, it's fine. You can also show like this.
Well, I know. Oh, okay, yeah.
So this pair more towards chlorine. Both are correct, no issues.
Yeah.
Yeah, you were saying something.
Okay, so right. Identify if these covalent bonds is nonpolar and explain your answer. So A is A and B are nonpolar and C is polar.
Yes, exactly.
So would you say for A and B, they both have the same elements? So the
electronegatives will be same, so no charge separation will be there.
Yeah. So electron negativity is this. Oh, do you say electron charge or electronegativity?
Yeah, you can say both are hydrogen atoms, their electronegativity values will be same. So they will pull pull equally the pair, no? Shared pair. The each hydrogen will pull by same strength, so the pair will remain in the center. No charges will be developed on either hydrogen atoms.
Yeah.
This will be the explanation. Similarly with the fluorine, both have four value of electronegativity, both will pull the pair with the same force and no charge separation, or you can say no charge development will be there on either fluorine atom.
Yeah.
And in HF, there is quite large difference in electronegativity values. No need to remember, I'm just telling you, hydrogen is 2.1, fluorine you already know it's having value 4. So fluorine will attract the pair towards itself and there will be development of delta negative 1 fluorine and delta positive 1 hydrogen.
Yeah.
Yes.
Arrange the following covalent bonds in order of increasing polarity. So would it be
increasing? We need to mention the increasing order means first of all, we need to write the least polar bond out of these three. Which one will be the least polar?
So would it be what's that? Hydrogen nitride?
It's not a compound actually. It's just a hydrogen nitrogen bond. You will not say hydrogen nitride.
Okay.
It's not a compound. So compound is basically ammonia. NH bond is there in ammonia. One of the example may be ammonia, but you will not use the compound name because it's not asked. They have just asked the bond. It is the least polar, then hydrogen oxygen bond, then hydrogen fluorine bond.
Yeah.
Why so? Because hydrogen is same. And if we compare electronegativities of fluorine, oxygen and nitrogen, nitrogen is having the least one, then oxygen, then fluorine. Fine?
Mm. Yeah.
I think all the questions are clear.
Yeah. Okay. I understand.
Have you gone through these intramolecular forces? You were saying yesterday that you will go through yourself.
No, I haven't gone through it yet, but I'll go through after, so it's fine. This one is all right. I understand, you know, the basic, like, which intermolecular forces there are and how they work.
Okay. So let us start with this bonding and physical properties.
Yeah.
So you are having your test tomorrow. No, today is Sunday. You have test on Tuesday.
Yeah.
You need to do a lot of work today because I think tomorrow is your working day, school day.
Yeah.
How many hours do you spend in school?
So I go to school at 8:30 and I finish at 4 o'clock.
Oh.
So around how many hours? 6, 8-ish hours.
Oh.
between 6 and 8 hours. It changes sometimes. Okay.
Any other Indian students also, or all are basically from the here only natives?
No. There are a lot of Indians in England and in my like class and everything.
Oh, great. Then yeah. You feel homely, no? Not on outside the type.
Yeah. No, it's nice.
Okay. Good. So you born here in England or in India?
I was born in Ireland.
Oh, England.
We moved to England like 5-6 years ago from Ireland. And
well, Ireland.
Both my parents.
Oh.
Yeah.
Oh. So the topic is bonding and physical properties. So I have gone through your topic. It's quite easy. No problem in it. Do you know about matter? Are you familiar with this word matter?
I've heard of it, but I'm not sure.
And like we are sitting right now, like I'm sitting in the room, you are sitting in your room, anything around us which has mass. So it's a very particular definition, anything which has mass and occupies space is called matter. Anything, even air, water, table, chair, pen, human beings, plants, flowers, everything is matter. Fine?
Okay. Yeah.
Which has mass and which occupies space. Air also occupies space. Air also has mass. So it will also be placed in category of matter. Fine?
Yeah.
Now, you know that everything is made up of atoms. The theory was given by Dalton. Actually, he gave the concept that every matter is made up of very tiny particles, which were later on were called as atoms, but you just remain on the word particles. Do you understand particles? Small, very little, little points like things. Okay.
Yeah.
Now, we need to study the energy changes present in these particles. Like you see, suppose you consider the gas present in your room right now. What do you imagine? A large number of very small, like you are not able to see the particles with naked eye, but you can imagine like large number of small particles roaming here and there. Isn't it?
Yeah.
If they are roaming here and there, they definitely possess some kinetic energy.
Yeah.
And similarly, if you have a glass of water, water is also made up of particles, H2O particles. They are also moving. No doubt they are moving very less as compared to particles of a gas, but even then they are moving.
Yeah.
Okay. They also possess some amount of kinetic energy. Like if you have a pen with you, it is a solid. The particles are also present in the pen, but they are not moving that much. They are only just vibrating around its mean position. Do you understand? Like suppose this is a particle, it is slowly vibrating like this, but still it is having some energy. It means whether a substance will exist in solid, liquid or gas, all these depend upon what the energy changes present in it.
Yeah.
Energy changes associated with the particles. So to understand these three states of matter, it is known as three states of matter: solid, liquid and gas. We are going to study it in little bit detail. Now, do you understand what is matter? Anything around us is matter? No.
Yeah.
Definitely only three states are possible. May it be in solid, may it be in liquid, may it be in gaseous state. Now, whether they exist in solid, liquid or gas, it depends upon the amount of the energy present in their particles. Fine?
Yeah.
Any doubt till now?
No, I understand it.
Okay. So I have just explained this paragraph, the before this table, fine?
Yeah.
Now in your book, the table shows comparison. Let us discuss it. The three states of matter, like solid, liquid, gas. You are feeling quite lazy. You are feeling quite lazy.
Yeah, I just woke up, so it's just...
Because
we went to a party yesterday and we came back around 3, half 3-ish.
So what is the time right now?
It's 9:30.
Oh, okay. All family members are sleeping.
Yeah.
Ayush is studying. Ayush have to study. Okay, no problem. You can draw the table. You will feel more active.
Yeah, ready.
So the first point is the particle arrangement. I'm just drawing the same way that is present in your book, but we are drawing by discussing, right?
Yeah.
Now, what do you think? What type of arrangement is there in solid? Like, consider any solid substance present nearby you. The atoms present in it, are they present in regular arrangement or random arrangement?
It would be regular if it's solid.
Yeah. Regular means they're present in well-defined proper system. And in liquid, the arrangement is comparatively random.
Yeah.
And in gas, it is more random. But we just write random word. Fine? Yeah. Is it clear? Now, what is the evidence for it? Evidence means what is the proof that we are saying that solids have regular arrangement?
Yeah.
Do you know that solids have fixed shapes?
Yeah, fixed shape.
Fixed shape. Like it's a... line is written in your book, straight edges. They have written straight, sharp edges. Do you understand edge?
Yeah.
Like I have this writing pad, this is its edge. Okay? So, is the shape of the liquids fixed? Or they attain the shape of the container in which they are present? They attain the shape of the container. Fine?
Yeah.
Attain the shape of the container. It means if they are able to attain the shape of the container, the particles arrangement is not fixed, not regular, it's random. They are moving here and there, so they attain the shape of the container in which they are present. Same with the gas, it also attain the shape of the container. If you release a gas in their room, it will occupy the whole of the room and the shape as well. And similarly, if you release a gas in some another container, it will attain shape of that. Fine?
Yeah.
The next point about them is spacing. Now, what do you think? In a solid, the particles are nearby or they are far apart?
They're very nearby.
Nearby. Tight. Tight packing, or you can say close particles are close to each other. Tight packing word is also good, but I'm using the word which is written in your book. The spacing is close again in liquid and far apart in gas.
Yeah.
Far apart means they are at a distance, large distance from each other. What is the evidence for this? Do you understand the meaning of compressibility?
Yeah, so like how easy it is to push it together or...
Okay, are solids compressible or they are incompressible?
So they're incompressible. It's hard to compress them.
Yeah, solids, we say solids are almost incompressible. Liquids are also almost incompressible, isn't it?
Yeah, but slightly less.
Yeah, but we just write incompressible. We have just put almost. It means in that particles are also close. Otherwise, if there are spaces between the particles, they should be able to, we should able to compress it. But it is incompressible. It means particles in liquid are also closer by. Gases are compressible. It means particles in the gas, they are far apart. And the third point is about the movement of the particles. Now, what do you think in a solid? Will they vibrate around the main position or they move freely?
They would vibrate because they're in a fixed position.
Yeah, vibrate around the main position, moving just slowly. And the liquids, it's a word is written in your book, rapid jostling. Like if you jostle something little bit more, like they are moving more rapidly, but not that freely. As in case of gas. Okay. You can also use simple words. Otherwise, if you're able to find these words easy, you can use these. Otherwise, simple words you can use.
Yeah.
Now, what is the proof for that? What is the evidence for that? Do you understand diffusion?
Diffusion.
Like if we use perfume, someone can even smell at a distance. Why? Because gases, particle diffuse from high concentration to low concentration. So gases, do solids diffuse? No.
Yeah.
Diffusion is very, very slow, almost negligible. Here also, negligible diffusion.
Yeah.
And they diffuse quite fast.
Yeah.
Like they are diffusing quite fast, it means the particles of the gas are moving. Fine.
Yeah.
I think differences should be clear. If you have any doubts, you can discuss with me right now. Models, we are just going to study. The diagram is given in your book.
Wait, so is it the diffusion in the, whatever matter is? So either say solid, nothing's going to diffuse into the solid or out of the solid.
We are saying the particles of the solid, are they moving themselves or not? If the gaseous particles are able to move, then they can, if you are using perfume, we are or our mother is cooking some delicious food in the kitchen. We smell by sitting in our room. How is possible? The vapors of the food, the vapors coming out of the food, they are moving into our room. Because in the kitchen, the concentration is high of the vapors, and in our room, the concentration is not there. So they are moving themselves. It's not like this something is going in or going out. We are talking about the particles of the substance itself, whether they are moving or not.
Yeah.
Whether particles of the solid are moving themselves or not. This is the concept of the diffusion. We are not discussing whether we are able to put something into it, that we are able if we put a hole. Like I have some solid box, suppose. If I put a hole drill into it, I can put something into it. That is not diffusion.
Yeah.
Okay. We are discussing whether the particles are moving themselves or not. Fine.
Yeah.
Okay. Now you can see this diagram. Particles vibrate about a point. This is a solid. If you heat it, just focus on this arrow. Are you able to see my cursor?
Yeah.
This arrow is known as half-headed arrow. Which arrow?
Half-headed.
Head.
Yeah.
Half-headed arrow. Now, if you are heating it again, it's changing into gaseous state. Fine?
Yeah.
Now, the other way, if you are cooling the gas, it's changing to liquid. If you're cooling the liquid, it's changing to solid.
Yeah.
Now, any reversible process, do you understand reversible?
Yeah.
Reversible process we show with half-headed arrow. Like suppose I have solid, it able to change to liquid by heating it, liquid able to change to solid by cooling it.
Yeah.
Reversible processes are shown by half headed arrows. Okay.
Yeah, that's fine.
Now, what is this PM, melting point? We are melting a solid and we are boiling a liquid, TB. TB is boiling point, T for temperature, B for boiling. Should I move ahead?
Yeah, that's fine.
Okay. Now, energy changes. Let us discuss. We have now gone through about the basic differences between solid, liquid and gas. Now, we are going to study about their energy changes. Okay?
Yeah.
Do one thing after the class, Ayush. Have you got the syllabus for your finals? Like you were saying, you will get an email or something like that.
Yeah, the teacher still hasn't sent me the thing. She's been off school for a bit, so I'll ask my other teacher.
Okay.
And she'll tell me tomorrow then.
I just want to confirm, is it sufficient to study on weekends? Is it helping you or you want more time or what?
Yeah.
I think it's sufficient.
Yeah, I'll see how it is with... I think we'll doing it on just the weekend will be enough.
Oh, okay. That is more comfortable actually. On weekdays, it is difficult to set the timings.
Yeah.
Isn't it?
Yeah, it is. Especially because I'm in school while you're working, also it's really difficult as well.
Yeah. No issues. Now let us discuss about heating a solid. Now just imagine a solid, like just imagine piece of ice, fine?
Yeah.
If you want to heat it, what will happen? What is there in ice? H2O molecules tightly packed close to each other, vibrating around a like mean position. Suppose this is the ice piece. There are different H2O particles are present and they're vibrating. Like suppose this is a particle, it is just vibrating around the mean position. Now, if you are heating it, what will happen? They will gain energy. The particles will gain energy and they will start moving more, little bit more.
Yeah.
Isn't it? Or you can say the forces in the solid starts breaking little bit so that it is able to move little bit more.
Yeah.
Or we can say like solid will expand on heating.
Yeah.
Can you, are you able to imagine this?
Yeah.
Okay. Then what will happen? Now we want to see how melting will take place. Melting is also known as fusion. Melting of solid into liquid. Like we want to convert ice to liquid water. Fine. Now you will heat it more.
Yeah.
Now, after some time, it will start moving more and more. And it will ultimately get changed from solid ice to liquid water.
Yeah.
Now, let me explain a few terms. The term I'm just going to write, it is latent heat of fusion. Latent heat of fusion, or it is also known as enthalpy of fusion or enthalpy of melting as well. Fine?
Yeah.
Concept is very easy, but it needs little bit attention. Like just in case of ice, if I write the values of latent heat, then I'll explain what is the meaning of latent heat. The value is 333.55 kilojoules per kg. Now, what is the mean? If you want to convert 1 kg ice, suppose I have how much ice? 1 kg ice. I want to convert it into liquid water. It will need some energy, isn't it?
Yeah.
How much energy it needs? This much. Do you understand? Yeah. Joule, kilojoules?
Yeah.
Take it. Now, but you see the temperature will not change. Have you ever gone through it that melting point of ice is 0 degrees Celsius?
Yeah.
(clears throat) And what is the freezing point of ice? It is also 0 degrees Celsius. So if you are melting ice, the temperature will remain 0 degrees Celsius. It will not change by absorbing this much energy. It means this energy, it is known as latent heat. What is the meaning of latent, Ayush? Latent word means hidden.
Yeah.
Do you know this? Hidden.
No, I didn't know. That's not right. Latent means hidden. Yeah.
Now that heat means energy. Fusion means melting. Focus. The amount of energy we are giving to 1 kg ice to change it into liquid water, that energy will not increase the temperature. Temperature of the ice before melting is 0 degrees. After absorbing this much energy, no doubt it will change to liquid water, but still its temperature will remain 0 degrees. Now you may think, where this amount of energy has gone, isn't it?
Yeah.
This amount of energy has gone into breaking the bonds of the H2O molecules which are present in the ice so that it gets free and get converted into liquid water.
Yeah.
That energy is not increasing the temperature. That is why we call it as latent heat. The amount of heat which will not increase the temperature, but it will convert the solid into liquid at the same temperature. That amount is known as latent heat of fusion, or you can say latent heat of melting.
Okay. So it doesn't increase, it doesn't change the temperature, but it breaks all the bonds. That's what the energy is used for.
It will not increase the temperature at all. Temperature will remain same. But where the energy gone, it's gone into the breaking the forces of the solid so that it gets converted into liquid.
Yeah.
And the process will be endothermic. I think you know endo-exo.
Yeah.
Endothermic means what? It will absorb. Why it will absorb? Because we are changing solid to liquid.
Yeah.
So to change
from solid, energy
will be absorbed.
Yeah. Wait, so is it when bonds are broken, energy is absorbed? When bonds are made, energy is released?
Yes.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Okay.
Now, I want to explain one more thing. If you want to freeze 1 kg water, suppose you have water 1 kg at 0 degrees Celsius, but it is in liquid form and you want to freeze it, this amount of energy will be released. Amount will remain same, but now the process will be exothermic. Are you getting? It will change to ice. Temperature will still remain 0 degrees. And this is known as latent heat of freezing.
Okay. So it's the same, just reversed.
Just reverse. Value of energy will remain same. One will be endo, another will be exo.
Yeah.
And why we are calling it latent? Because it is not increasing. It is not changing the temperature. It is just changing its physical state by breaking or forming the bonds. And enthalpy word is also means energy.
Yeah.
And we will study in energetics, constant pressure, pressure remains constant. Then we use the word enthalpy. Temperature also remains constant. Pressure will also remain constant.
Yeah.
Okay. So you can use either the latent heat of fusion, or you can also use the word enthalpy of fusion or enthalpy of melting.
Yeah.
Is it clear?
Yeah, it's clear.
Okay. All these points are written here. You can see your notebook.
Yeah.
Now heating a liquid. Now just imagine what will happen. It's very easy. If you have understood this concept, latent heat of fusion, you will understand again vaporization concept. Now what will happen if we want to heat a liquid? Now we have converted ice to liquid water. Now we want to again heat this liquid water. Suppose we have this beaker and we are heating it. Again, we are giving it energy, isn't it?
Yeah.
Molecule will moving more apart and apart each other because they are absorbing energy. Now it will change to vapor form. It will change to gas form, isn't it?
Yeah.
Now the suppose I'm just dealing with the example of water. It may be any another substance. I think you can well imagine that we are just taking the example of water. Now, here again, latent heat of vaporization, or you can use the word enthalpy of vaporization. Now again, if we arrive the value for water, you no need to remember it. I'm just taking again so that you can imagine. If we want to convert 1 kg water, suppose we have 1 kg water at 100 degrees Celsius, but it is still in the liquid form. I think you must have seen water boiling at 100 degrees Celsius. It has not converted into steam. But if we want to convert it into steam, means into the gaseous form, we have to give it this much energy. Though the temperature of the steam will also remain 100 degree. It means this energy is not used to increase the temperature. This energy is being used to change the state, physical state, by breaking the bond still present in water at 100 degree to change it into steam form, gaseous form. So we are calling it as latent hidden heat. Heat is doing its work in a hidden form, hidden way. Latent heat of vaporization or enthalpy means again how much heat it has absorbed.
Yeah.
You must have studied that heat has many times, steam has many times energy as compared to even boiling water. Like suppose if we want to attack someone, if we put it a boiling water on it, it will cause less danger. If we use steam, it will cause many more time danger to him. Why? Because steam is having this much more energy per kg than boiling water.
Yeah.
Is it clear? Latent heat of vaporization?
Yeah, it's clear. Yeah. So what's it called? Wait, if it's going from gas to liquid, is it called latent heat of condensation?
Yeah, latent heat of condensation. Exactly. Same value, just the opposite process, exothermic.
And is there anything for like sublimation straight from solid to gas or not?
Yeah, that process also happens. Like in case of iodine, it directly changes from gas to solid to gaseous.
In case of what?
Iodine crystals.
Oh, okay. They turn straight from ice to...
They sublime. They directly change from solid to gas form. That energy is called enthalpy of sublimation.
Okay, yeah.
Actually, name will depend upon the type of the process only.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah. We have covered up to here. Now, if you want to heat gas again, it will not change its state, but your molecules will absorb more energy and they will move just more far apart from each other, expand. It's written gaseous, expand. Okay. I don't think we will be able to complete the whole topic. We will just able to complete the crystals, I think, because I'm able to teach you 1 hour only, not 2 hours today. Then how you will cover the remaining one?
I'll just do it by myself, it's fine.
Or tomorrow if you're free, we can manage, you can tell me. Otherwise it's difficult, then we can leave it.
It's fine. I'm gonna be revising all day anyways, so I'll just watch a few videos and try and understand it, and I'll practice some questions.
Video, YouTube videos, journal?
Yeah.
It takes time otherwise. It's also a good way, but just it takes time.
Yeah.
So, is this your first experience of, from Indian teacher or what?
Yeah, it is.
So, how's the experience overall?
It's good. You're really good at helping me understand the topics.
Okay. Earlier, I was not sure, will I be able to teach you or not?
Yeah.
I think your uncle is my sir's friend. Then he insisted.
Yeah.
So, yeah. So, the next topic is crystals. Okay, it's nothing special in it. It's just the solid forms like we earlier studied, no? Ionic compound, covalent compound. It's just another form of it. Like crystals are those substances which are present in the solid form. And there is some regular arrangement of particles.
Yeah.
Actually, basically, if you study that, there is a chapter called solid state chapter. I don't know. I think the chapter will be there in your 13th level. In India, the chapter is there in plus two students. Okay.
Yeah.
So there are two types of solid. One are crystalline and another are amorphous. I'm just giving you extra information. It is not in your book. Just try to understand it. Crystalline solids and another solids are amorphous. Crystalline solids are those, Ayush, which have regular arrangement. Like suppose if we are arranging particles, both are solids. Just keep in mind, we are not talking about any other state. We are not talking about liquid or gas. We are talking only about the solid. Crystalline solid means particles have regular arrangement. They are present at certain fixed distances in a certain fixed geometry. Now, what is the amorphous solid? Like if you take the example of the glass, it seems to be regular arrangement, but if you study structure in detail, if you study the structure of the glass at the molecular level, its arrangement is not regular. Like initially it seems to be regular, but after some time particles becoming random, their distances will change. Some present at the large distance, some present at the small distance, their geometries will change. If the arrangement is not regular, its solid is called amorphous. If the arrangement is regular, solid is called crystalline or crystals. Right? Yeah. It means that's we are dealing with the regular arrangement of the particles.
Yeah.
And the forces, again, the particle forces may be strong forces present in them, like ionic bonds, covalent bonds, or metallic bonds.
Mm.
Some type of bonding will definitely be there, no? Even if there's crystalline solids, in particles, there will be some type of bonding. It may be ionic bonding, it may be covalent bonding, it may be metallic bonding.
Metallic, yeah.
Or weak bonding may also be present. Intermolecular forces, like you must have gone through the topic, dipole-dipole forces.
Yeah.
Van der Waals forces.
Or hydrogen bonds.
Yeah, hydrogen bonds. These come in the category of weak forces. Either they may be present as the intermolecular forces or strong forces may be present. In some cases, even both the forces are present in a crystal.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, there are four types of crystals are there. Like if we write ionic crystals, it's mentioned in your book very clearly. Ionic crystals. Then they have metallic crystals. Molecular crystals. And macromolecular crystals.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, what about the ionic crystals? Like again, in the first class, we discussed about the NaCl bonding in the same way. Positive, negative ions will be formed, electrostatic forces will be there, high melting point. So, please remember that ionic crystals have high melting points.
Yeah.
Due to again, and they will form the lattice. Lattice means structure will go on repeating. Na plus Cl negative, Na plus Cl negative, like so on. They have particular geometry.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, metallic crystal, yesterday we studied the metallic bond, metallic compounds, we studied metals.
Hmm.
electrons same order. Do you remember kernels I told you?
Yeah.
There is a sea of delocalized electrons and positive kernels are embedded in it.
Yeah.
So again, they have this strong bonding metallic bonds come in the category of strong bonds. So again, they will be having high melting boiling points.
Yeah.
Like you can see, high melting temperature is a result of strong metallic bonds. And in case of sodium chloride temperature, their melting point is 801 degrees Celsius. Do you know how to convert degrees Celsius into Kelvin?
Yeah, you add 273.15.
Yeah, exactly 0.15 or approximately you can add. Now, molecular crystals, it's very simple. Like simple covalent compounds you can take, like just we discussed iodine example. It comes in the category of molecular crystals. Now, let us discuss it. Now, if you discuss iodine is a halogen. Do you know halogen?
Yeah.
Group 17 elements are known as halogens.
Yeah.
Like you have fluorine, chlorine, bromine, iodine. They are present in the 17th group in a vertical column. Fine?
Yeah. Yeah.
And do you know that all the elements present in a group have same number of valence electrons? Do you know this?
Yeah. Yeah.
So it is very much clear that all the halogens will be having 7 valence electrons, isn't it?
Yeah.
So iodine is also a halogen. It will have 7 valence electrons. If I want to draw it, I will show in this way. Right?
Yeah.
Now they are sharing again. Mutual sharing is there. So single covalent bond will be there.
Yeah.
So it's a solid. Do you know that iodine exists in solid form at room temperature?
No, I thought it was liquid.
Liquid. No.
Yes, gas. Yeah.
Chlorine, they're gaseous. Bromine is liquid. And iodine is solid. At room temperature, I'm talking about room temperatures.
Okay.
Okay, it's black, purple colored solid crystals are there of iodine. And they come in the category of molecular crystals. They have simple covalent bonds among them. But the point is, you are having a crystal. It don't have single molecule. It will have millions, trillions of I2 molecules, isn't it?
Yeah.
Now the covalent bonds are present between the iodine atoms. And what about the bonding between one I2 and another I2 molecule?
Would they have weak intermolecular forces?
Weak van der Waals forces.
Yeah.
Weak van der Waals. Is it fine? So please take care that covalent bonds are strong, very strong bonds are there, but they are present among the iodine atoms only. Between different I2 molecules, no covalent bonding is there. They will have weak van der Waals forces among them.
Yeah.
So what do you think? A molecular crystals, will they have high melting points or low melting points?
They would have low melting points. Points yes. Because they are weak.
This is very important. Ionic and metallic crystals, they have high melting point, but molecular crystals, they have low melting points. A question can come like covalent bonds are quite strong, even then why they have low melting point? Then what would be your answer? You will answer that covalent bonds are present only between the atoms. Between different molecules of the crystal, we don't have covalent bonds, we have weak van der Waals forces.
Yeah.
Right. It's a very beautiful diagram is given in your book, like you can see. Do you know nanometer?
Nanometer.
Yeah, it's written distance between a pair of covalently bonded iodine is 0.267 nanometer. What is nanometer? Yeah.
It's, I think it's one tenth of a micrometer. No, well, one tenth of a micrometer. No.
You can simply relate with the meter. It's 10 raised to the power minus 9 meter.
Yeah.
Means?
Was it 10 to the power of minus 9?
What is the meaning practically if you see? Like suppose you have 1 meter distance. Suppose this distance is 1 meter.
Yeah.
Now 10 raised to the power 9 means 9 zeros are there, isn't it?
Yeah.
Now if you do its parts, this many parts practically, yeah. Suppose, imagine if you do it 10 raised to power 9 parts, each part will known as 1 nanometer.
Yeah.
This is the practical meaning. Like we can imagine it only. Because atoms or molecules, they have very short distances. No.
Yeah.
And the distance between a pair of molecules is 0.354 nanometer. Why it's more?
Wait, bonds between pair of covalent bonds between pair. Is it because covalent bonds are stronger, so they hold it closer together, but van der Waals are weaker, so the it's less distance. Easy for it to hold it. Yeah, larger distance.
So distance, yeah, very good. Now, due to the weak forces, the crystals will be soft.
Mm.
And we are able to break it easily. Is it fine?
Yeah.
Temperature are low, sublime. You were asking, sublime, iodine sublimes.
Yeah.
And it don't conduct electricity because it don't have any charged particles in it.
Yeah, it doesn't.
Have you understood molecular crystals?
Yeah, I understand it.
Now, last type is macromolecular crystals. Let us discuss it. Macromolecular crystals. This is very interesting here. Macro means big.
Yeah.
Molecular crystal, no doubt it will have covalent bonds. Now, the covalent bonds will extend throughout the whole structure. So, it don't have any van der Waals forces. Like if you take the example of the diamond. One carbon is bonded with the four carbon atoms with the covalent bonds. But this structure will go on in continuation with the whole of the lattice, you can say.
Yeah.
That is why diamond, though it is molecular crystal, so it comes in the category of macromolecule, it is having very, very high melting boiling points. Why?
Yeah.
Because covalent bonds extend throughout the structure.
Yeah.
In the previous one, covalent bonds were only present in the small molecules. They were not present in between the molecules. But here,
yeah.
Nothing like molecular entity is there. The whole joint structure will be there. Do you understand joint? Big structure.
Yeah.
So all the atoms are bonded by strong covalent bonds, which need large amount of energy to break. Are you getting?
Yeah, I understand it, yeah. Because there's no van der Waals forces holding the molecules together, there's only the covalent bonds. It means it has a high melting point and boiling point, and it's a strong structure.
Yes. So the difference is that in macromolecular, covalent bonds extend throughout the structure.
Yeah.
And in those only molecular crystals, like covalent bonds were just present among the atoms, not among the molecules.
Wait, so for graphite, it has weak intermolecular forces and it has, covalent bonds throughout the structure. So is it macromolecule or?
Yeah, I'm just going to discuss. I think you are asking about graphite.
Yeah.
Let me discuss. Structure of graphite. Graphite is also a macromolecular crystal. Now what happens in graphite, each carbon forms only 3 bonds.
Yeah.
Now if you see that carbon, 1s2, 2s2, 2p2, do you know this type of diagrams?
Yeah, I know that.
I have drawn 2s and 2p. Now, before forming bond, this 2s electron, this forms like this. Have you studied concept of hybridization?
Concept of?
Hybridization.
I don't think so.
Okay, no issues. Leave it then. It will create confusion otherwise.
Yeah.
These 3 electrons are taking part in bond formation in graphite. The 4th electron is free.
Yeah.
Now, if a carbon form 3 bonds, the structure will be planar, trigonal planar?
Yeah, planar, yeah, trigonal planar.
In diamond, the structure was tetrahedral.
Yeah.
With bond angle 109.5 degree. Do you know this?
Yeah. So would the bond angle be 120 in the signal planner?
Yeah, it's 120 in graphite. Okay. Now each carbon is forming three bonds only. And it is forming these type of sheets. You can see if I extend this structure. Now you can see, just focus on any atom. This is atom, it's forming 1, 2, 3. It will extend like this way. Okay, it will form hexagonal sheets. What type of sheets? Hexagonal sheets. Now, covalent bonds are there, no doubt, but it will form like layers of sheets. This like one layer of sheet, another layer of sheet. Like my hand is one layer of sheet, another. In between these different layers, no covalent bonds are there. These are the van der Waals forces.
Okay.
Okay, have you understood?
Yeah.
Now, van der Waals forces are the weak. That is why one layer can slide over the another layer. That is why we can use graphite as a lubricant. Do you know graphite is being used as a lubricant in machinery?
Yeah.
That is why pencil lead, it is also made up of graphite. We are able to write it on the notebook. It is called flaky carbon. Graphite is flaky. Again, due to hexagonal rings and the weak van der Waals forces due to which you are able to slide. And what about the fourth electron which is free? That is why graphite is a good conductor of electricity, because the fourth electron is free, it's roaming here and there. But it can conduct electricity only in the sheet, not to the right angle.
Okay.
Among the planes, it can conduct electricity, not in at the right angle state. And graphite, no electron is free. So it's a bad conductor of electricity, and graphite is a good conductor.
Yeah.
Is it clear?
Yeah, it's clear. Yeah, I understand it.
All these points are written. The fourth electron is like behaving delocalized. Why? Because it's roaming here and there, no? It's free. Fine? That's why it's soft. Its melting point will be high. Take care?
Yeah.
No doubt, van der Waals forces are there, but overall, it's a quite big structure.
So it still has a high melting point.
But very less than that of diamond. But in general, it's having high comparatively.
Yeah.
But low than diamond.
Yeah.
Fine?
Yeah, that's fine.
Actually, all these are the allotropes of carbon. Do you know allotropes?
Allotropes, I've heard of it. Does it just mean like different version?
Diamond, graphite, and one more there. Not detailed structure is there in your syllabus. Fullerenes.
Fullerenes, yeah.
Fullerenes. Buckminster fullerene.
Yeah.
Allotropes means the different forms of an element having same chemical properties. CP means chemical property, but different physical properties.
Okay, yeah.
All these are made up of carbon. If you burn diamond or graphite, it will change to carbon dioxide, isn't it? Because they're made up of the same substance.
Yeah.
So it means their chemical properties are same, but their structure is different. Their melting boiling points are different. A lot of difference in their physical properties.
Yeah.
Such forms are known as allotropes. Same chemical properties, but different physical properties.
Yeah.
Of the same element. So you can say forms of the same element, forms of an element having same chemical properties, but different physical properties, they are known as allotropes.
Yeah, that's fine.
There is a word written in your book, polymorphs. It's a just meaning the same as allotropes.
Okay, yeah.
But it's allotropes we use just for an element, like carbon. Carbon is an element. Polymorphs is a general term we can use for compounds as well. But you can say allotropy is a subset of polyforms. Polymorphism. Polymorphism. It's called polymorphism.
Polymorphism,
in your book, both the words are used as synonyms of each other. But technically, allotropy is particularly for element, and polymorphism is a general wide term.
Yeah. That's fine.
Okay. I think we have to close the session now.
Yeah, that's fine.
So,
thank you very much.
Tomorrow, I'll be able to give, if you want, any doubts if you have. If you study yourself, if you have doubts, you can message me. I'll help you through WhatsApp, or if you able to arrange some time, we can. Fine? Yeah.
Is it possible for you to share me the recording of this session?
Yeah, sure. I'll send you. I have also the recording of the previous two. I'll also send you.
Yeah. Thank you. Yeah.
Okay. But it will take some time. Okay.
Yeah.
I need to convert it. I'm not able to send it. It's a heavy one.
Yeah. That's fine. Yeah. That's no problem.
Good luck for your test. If you want any help, please message.
Yeah, no problem. Thank you very much.
Bye.
Bye.